Microcredit refers to the short-term lending of small sums of money, sometimes as little in value as $50 or $100. Furthermore, there's usually no explicit collateral, so a group of, say, five individuals or five families might borrow from a microcredit institution, and each of the families is responsible for making sure that the other families repay the money. If one family cannot repay, the other families are on the hook. Microcredit thus uses small groups to monitor and enforce repayment. Sometimes individuals just borrow once from a microcredit lender, repay the loan, and that's that. But it's quite common that families borrow from microcredit lenders on a recurring basis. They will take out some short-term loans for 3 or 6 months, and once they repay those loans, they turn around and immediately borrow some more. There's a puzzle in microcredit, and that is, how can these poor families afford to pay the rates of interest they're paying to the lender? It's not unusual for a microcredit loan to have an annualized rate of interest of, say, 50 or 100%. So if you're borrowing money at an annualized rate of, say, 50%, what is it you can do with the money that's so valuable that could possibly justify such a high rate of interest on your repayment? Some people, of course, are bankrupted by their microcredit loans, but we also find many cases, in fact the majority of cases, where those microcredit loans are put to good use. Sometimes microcredit loans are used to start new businesses, and the new business may yield a rate of return which justifies the payment of the interest. These new businesses don't have to be large multinational corporations. In fact, they pretty much never are. But imagine someone living in a village who wants to set up a shop to sell, say, cards for cell phones, and that individual needs some initial capital. Well, there's one rationale for microcredit. Other individuals use microcredit to finance their means of transport. Say you need to buy a scooter or a motorbike, maybe to help bring your child to school or to get to a job on the other side of town, or to help run your business and buy some inputs or supplies and bring them back to your shop. Well, for all of those purposes, you might need transportation, and again there, you'll need some initial startup capital, and the rate of return on getting that transportation might be quite high. A lot of microcredit isn't invested, even though maybe sometimes it's supposed to be, but it's used for purposes of consumption. And when I say consumption, I don't usually mean buying fancy diamonds. It can be something as simple and as essential as taking one's child to the doctor when the child becomes sick. Again, there you'll see that having some liquid assets on hand through the microcredit can mean a very high rate of return. Especially in rural areas, sometimes microcredit is invested in animals. A poor family in a rural area might prefer to have some animals around rather than to have a large or even moderate-sized stock of cash. When there's a lot of cash around, there's a tendency that relatives or friends come and ask basically for their share of the cash because they need it for some urgent purpose. Social norms can make it difficult to resist. Yet with animals, there's not necessarily the same problem. If you have a cow in your backyard rather than some cash in your home, it's much harder for your friends and acquaintances to come along and ask for their share of the cow. So microcredit can allow rural families to save resources in more efficient and more productive ways. Finally, the comparison isn't between microcredit and all of these families having high net worth. That's simply not going to be the case. To a large extent, what has happened is that microcredit has replaced traditional village or urban money lenders, and however high the rates of interest may seem on micro loans, well, they actually are usually lower than the rates of interest from the money lenders. The money lender will charge more, and furthermore, if you don't pay back the money lender, often the money lender is actually less gentle than has often been the case with microcredit institutions, which have a public reputation to maintain to a greater extent. In another unit, we'll now look at the empirical evidence on just how much of microcredit is useful and how much is not.